Hello, welcome to the final programme from us here at South Today in Oxford. In tonight's programme, a rise in the number of people seeking help for addiction. Wayne tells us about his recovery from alcoholism at a treatment centre in Oxfordshire. Also, the path to school parents say is unsafe and want free bus journeys to continue for their children. And 22 years after we started, as we say goodbye, we look back at some of the stories we've covered. Good evening. An addiction treatment centre in Banbury has told us it's seeing an increase in health and social care workers seeking out its services. Banbury Lodge treats people for a range of addictions from alcohol to gambling and eating disorders. Last year, the Lodge admitted 657 people for treatment. So far this year, it's already seen more than 700, with the Christmas period often one of its busiest times. It says it believes the cost of living crisis is playing its part. Peter Cook's been given exclusive access to the centre.
The reality for a so-called functioning alcoholic. Passed out, devoid of hope. This was Wayne's life for years. He recovered from an addiction to cocaine, only for alcohol to take a grip.
Drinking to blackout, and my son, you know, picking me up off the bathroom floor. And he'd already climbed me up, you know, and I'd cut my nose open and the top of my head. I can't remember a thing. And that is pathetic for you. That should be me looking after my son, not my son looking after me.
Now a year sober after drinking up to 20 cans of cider and a bottle of whiskey a day.
A year ago, I didn't want to wake up. I didn't have the guts to kill myself because of my son and didn't want to let him down. And now I can't wait to wake up. Got a good family, a loving family, and life is great. Yeah, I couldn't wish for any better at the minute.
He was one of more than 650 people admitted to Banbury Lodge Treatment Centre last year. So far this year, more than 700 have been through a 28-day residential programme. Centre bosses say it's the result of COVID and the cost of living crisis.
We've actually seen a rise in healthcare professionals contacting us, doctors, nurses needing treatment, from teachers to mechanics, any kind of anyone just needing help at the moment with any kind of behaviour, because we look at addiction, but it's not just alcohol and drugs. There's a lot of prescription drugs going on, but also eating disorders.
Those in charge here say they're expecting to see a further rise in the number of those in need, those struggling for money, for hope, for a way through the fog of addiction, but that support is available to them and their families to find a new future. Peter Cook, BBC South Today.
If you've been affected by any of the issues in that report, you can head to the BBC's Action Line. Taxis in Swindon are being equipped with life-saving bandages that stop people bleeding out if they've been stabbed. RapAid, a charity set up by a former Wiltshire police firearms officer, handed out the military bandages outside Swindon station. The scheme follows the recent stabbing of 18-year-old Owen Dunn in Penhill.
No one is expecting the taxi drivers to become a pseudo-paramedic. They are carrying these for us. They're carrying these for the emergency services as well. The police officers know that they're on board. They know that they can, if they see one of those stickers, a RapAid sticker, they know they can flag that taxi down and say, we need your bandages, we need your bandages. Something dreadful's happened, and they're there.
Railway workers are staging their second 48-hour strike this week in the long-running row over pay and conditions. Members of the RMT union walked out today and will do so again tomorrow. Passengers are being told to expect major disruption. An extremely reduced service will operate on a limited number of routes. Parents in a North Oxfordshire village are campaigning against the removal of the free seat scheme on their school bus. The county council's told them there is a safe walking route available, but the parents say the route is isolated and unsafe. Sarah Loudon has been to look at the council's suggested walking route. We can join her now outside Upper Hayford School. Sarah.
Yes, Jerry, this isn't the first time we've covered a story like this. You may remember in May last year, parents near Didcot had similar concerns about the route to school their children were being asked to walk. But if Oxfordshire County Council assess a walking route to be safe, the child is over 8 and within 3 miles of the school, they do not, in most circumstances, qualify for a free school place on the bus. Tracy, we walked one of these proposed safe routes earlier today. You live in Lower Hayford. Your children come here to Hayford Park. Your child comes here to Hayford Park School. What are your concerns about this route?
Well, as you could see from the walk that we did earlier, the winter months is pretty treacherous. Once the frost and snow is gone, you've then got flooding. The canal and the river both merge. You've got mud. You've got an isolated area. And you've also got, in the winter months, the darkness. These children are expected to walk in the dark on the way home. So the other alternative route is across the fields. Again, you've got flooding across one of those fields in the winter months or in the wet season. So it just becomes impassable.
Now, the County Council has assessed these routes. They've been down to the site. They say they are safe if an adult is accompanying the child. Is that an option for you, Maddie?
No. Like most working parents, to take 3 hours a day to walk with children to school is simply not practical. And a lot of parents also have younger children they'd have to take with, either holding a baby or trying to push a pushchair across those paths. And whilst the County Council criteria don't have to take these sort of considerations into account, they're not practical, they're not working, and it's not common sense.
Now, we've had a response from Oxfordshire County Council. They say in a statement that the assessment of walking routes, including footpaths, is carried out in line with the Department for Education statutory guidance and following procedures specified by Road Safety GB called Assessment of Walked Routes to School. We rigorously follow this guidance. Now, I guess council budgets only go so far, Tracy. Yeah. Do you accept there has to be a cut-off somewhere?
We do appreciate this, but what we would like to do is to invite the council to come and reassess the route with the emergency services, because the terrain and with the river one side, the canal the other side, this is not practical.
Thank you very much for your time. I know we're going to be following here at South today these parents' campaign as they try and appeal the council's decision.
Thanks, Sarah. Still to come in tonight's programme, as we say goodbye, we look back at the campaign to protect maternity services at the Horton Hospital. We'll be live in Banbury. It's just over 22 years since this service based in Oxford started. For viewers in Oxfordshire, Buckinghamshire, Swindon, those living around Brackley in Northamptonshire and people in the North Cotswolds. But the BBC has decided to close the service. Tonight we're broadcasting from our studios in Summertown in Oxford for the final time. So we've been back through our archives to show you some of the major stories we've covered over the last two decades.
Hello and welcome to South Today, a brand new programme for your region.
Good evening. Union members at BMW's Cowley plant near Oxford claim 2,500 jobs have been put at risk.
Southmoor is tonight a village in shock over the apparent death of resident Dr. David Kelly, the scientist at the centre of the Iraq dossier row.
Police believe Jermaine Lindsay was responsible for the attack in Russell Square in which 26 people died. He lived here on Northern Road in Aylesbury.
Fueled by booze, bravado and the bank holiday spirit, jumping off Magdalen Bridge seemed like a good idea to these partygoers, but it wasn't.
Good evening. Welcome to RAF Brize Norton in West Oxfordshire. It's been an historic day for the base as it formally took over the duties of RAF Lynham in Wiltshire, which is due to close next year.
Good evening. The streets of Swindon fell silent this afternoon as the town said goodbye to Sian O'Callaghan, the 22-year-old whose remains were found in a shallow grave last month.
Hello and welcome to South Today. In tonight's programme, the government's apologised to the family of an Oxford teenager who died in NHS care.
Dame Vivian Westwood certainly knows how to make an entrance. Aboard a tank on the way to David Cameron's constituency home.
Tonight we're in South Oxfordshire, where a series of deliberate arson attacks has caused destruction on an unprecedented scale. The council headquarters here all but destroyed, other buildings severely damaged.
The search for survivors is continuing at Didcot Power Station after part of a building collapsed yesterday, killing one man and seriously injuring five others. Three men are still missing and hope is fading of finding them alive.
Good evening. Welcome to the brand new Westgate Centre. It's been long awaited, cost £440 million and is roughly three times the size of the old centre.
They've managed to get away with a £60, 18-carat gold toilet worth up to $5 million.
Hundreds of PC Harper's colleagues line the route. A farewell to a fellow officer and friend.
In tonight's programme, the Oxford vaccine for COVID-19. As the rollout gets underway at the Churchill Hospital, we hear from GPs who'll be delivering it in the community.
For 3 years and 8 months, Leah Croucher's disappearance brought only questions and no answers. Today, that changed.
The family of Harry Dunn say they finally have justice for him after US citizen Ann Sekoulis admitted causing death by careless driving. Goodness me, 22 years, where does the time go? Now, in recent weeks, we've been asking you which stories you feel have had the biggest impact on you. One in particular was mentioned several times, the campaign to save maternity services at the Horton General. So tonight, our reporter David Lum is live for us in Banbury. David, you've covered this story yourself for a long time.
Geraldine, I've been a journalist for the past 16 years. One of my first jobs was actually inside in this market town. The threat to services at the Horton Hospital has been incredibly important to people during that time. It's something that people feel incredibly passionate about, and that's why we felt it was only fitting to relook at that story again tonight.
As we marched up from the cross to the hospital, the cars were going past and you were obviously broadcasting the news on BBC Oxford, so people were hearing about the significant win. And they were beeping and it was joyous.
Charlotte will never forget the day the then Health Secretary Alan Johnson threw out plans to downgrade maternity services at the Horton to a midwife-led unit.
We were told that we would have access to the IRP's findings. I was working for a company in Bloxham and I had a cameraman with me and I logged on and I had a look and I just was dumbfounded. And I just said, oh my God, we've done it. It's emotional, sorry. Every single thing was thrown out by a panel of experts.
It was the result campaigners had been fighting for years. But it wasn't to last. 8 years after those celebrations, the maternity unit was downgraded anyway due to a shortage of doctors. It was meant to be a temporary change, but they've never come back. BBC South Today has followed every twist and turn.
Came with us up to London when we took coaches up to attend demos. You were there for all of our celebrations here. You've had people out here when we've gathered the coverage given us by BBC Television, BBC Oxford Television and Radio, and the Banbury Guardian here, obviously in Banbury, has just been stunning. And we thank you and we applaud you.
A later attempt to overturn the move at the Royal Courts of Justice failed. Campaigners, though, are determined not to make that the end of the story. They fight on.
It's been exhausting and totally draining, but it's something that once you start, you've got to keep going.
Well, joining me now is Sophie Hammond. Her daughter was born at the Horton Hospital prior to the changes, but you're still calling for those changes to be reversed. Sophie, why is it so important to you?
Because with childbirth, a low-risk situation can go
to an emergency very quickly, and that's exactly what happened to me. I gave birth to a healthy baby girl, but immediately afterwards I'd had a massive hemorrhage and was being rushed into theatre for emergency surgery and a blood transfusion. And, you know, without the presence of the consultants on site, I don't think I'd be here today. At Keep the Horton General, we've proven that small obstetric units can and do sustain themselves up and down the country. Where there's a will, there's a way, so we believe it can be done. And you only have to look at how this area is growing and the huge catchment that the Horton serves to see that we absolutely need this service. And the only thing that's changed since the powers that be decided to save the Horton in 2008 is that the population has grown and the traffic is worse.
Well, I just want to get a word as well with Richard Howarth, the former editor of the Banbury Guardian. Richard, obviously this is an issue that you covered many times yourself. What do you think is the importance of the local media when it comes to covering an issue like this, a story like this?
Well, a key part of our role is to hold the powers that be to account. And when they make a decision that really is against the interests of the community, that's when we can get involved. And the Horton has united all opinions in Banbury across the years. The thing that has not changed is that Oxford is still as far away from Banbury as it ever was. And as the established media, one of our roles in that campaign and supporting the others involved is to ask questions with an expectation that we get an answer.
Well, it's obviously a story, as I said at the top of my report, that resonates strongly here. People feel very passionately about it. We did ask the Trust about the latest status for this hospital tonight, and it said that it's shown that the current service is safe and effective with improved outcomes for mothers and babies. It says it's made a commitment to have a regular review of the arrangements.
David, thank you. Over the years, lots of well-known faces have passed through our region, often appearing on stage or in films. I love doing those interviews. I've picked out some of them, starting in 2014 with a rising star in the world of robotics called Artie, who wasn't as smart as he claimed.
Look into my eyes and keep still. I would say you are a 32-year-old man. Your face is happy.
My first hit record here in this country, I was 9. Yeah, it was Long-Haired Lover from Liverpool.
Can you bear to have a look at that? Does it make you want to cry for sure?
Go on, torture me. Let's torture everyone, shall we? I'll be your
Valentine and you'll be mine. Am I the bride?
You're the bride.
Then why did I dress him up as the bride? You can go on YouTube, just go to my website, and just put Robin into Ricky Gervais and you'll see him in all sorts of predicaments.
We only had 3 TV channels then and massive viewing figures, yes. So it really made a big difference.
Who'd have thought the 80s would be so big again?
I think I got 25% of the vote, despite being from a girl.
Is it what you were expecting when you used to think about it when you were younger?
So I couldn't really imagine myself doing anything else.
Your divorce, I don't know what the word is, whether it's unlucky, unfortunate...
Batty, I think, is the right word, because it's all to do with Californian marital law.
Do you think that Alice ever feels bad about it? I'd feel really bad about
it. I don't know. I really don't.
So as I sit here, the majority of cells in this space are bacterial.
I am, of course, made of sugar and spice.
You are indeed.
Geraldine and I are both surprised by how much we're loving it, really loving it, being out on the water. I broke up, I sent you again.
Everything that I'd owned, I threw it out the windows, came along. Every day I get in the boat, I keep thinking I'll have forgotten what I learned the day before and won't be able to do it, so I'm keeping my fingers crossed I won't mess up on Sunday.
Personal favourite for me, I was obsessed with her, was the continuity announcer in Victoria Wood, as seen on TV.
We'd like to apologise to viewers in the north. It must be awful for them.
How much of that character came from you and how much from Victoria?
I'd say all Victoria.
So that brings me on to Victoria Beckham. I guess she might fall into that
category. Who did sell her wedding for £1 million. Well, that's a classic case where the Beckhams, who I love the Beckhams.
Boy, like this, and it's one of my freezes losers, and look at each other, you two, and go,
I have taught myself a magic trick.
Oh, goody, goody.
Fantastic. I get a card, you can pick a card. Is that all done?
Great.
I'm getting a reservation. I think your card was the 4 of clubs.
How does she do?
And that's magic. Jerome's here now, like the old days. If you were wondering why me, a journalist, was doing a card trick with a superstar magician Paul Daniels. It's because Paul had hurt his hand really badly with a saw trying to make a magic trick in his garage. And I thought, you can't have Paul Daniels in and have no magic. So I taught myself that card trick.
And how did Debbie McGee feel about his new glamorous assistant?
Very not threatened.
She liked it, but not a lot.
Very good.
We're nearing the end of the programme. South Today from Oxford has been about reflecting our communities, of course. Sport does that as well. And I just want to take a couple of minutes to reflect on some of the highs and lows, the stories and characters from the past two decades. When we started the Oxford edition of South Today, it was a time of change. Oxford United were in the process of leaving the Manor Ground to move to the Kassam Stadium, but there they'd fall out of the Football League.
Oxford United are relegated. They have lost their Football League status.
Only to rise back with a dramatic Wembley win.
The 3-1 win over York brings in an extra £750,000 to the club.
Swindon's existence has also been up and down, albeit the yo-yo string's been shorter. There's no doubt they brought us the most colourful of managers as well. We actually gained a football team, the controversial relocation of Wimbledon FC to become MK Dons, and ultimately they moved to the Stadium MK. But it still rankles with some. Aylesbury United lost their ground, but not before they'd welcomed England for a pre-World Cup warm-up fixture. Aylesbury would also give us one of England's first ever football European champions. Well done, Ellen White. Well, our area has been such a driving force in motorsport as well. Despite numerous threats of losing the British Grand Prix, it remains at Silverstone, and local teams have brought us world champions aplenty. A little life on Mars there. Olympic champions have been celebrated in the stadium and on the water, and one of the most glorious years for sport was 2012, when ahead of the London Games, the Olympic torch and thousands of smiles lit up our region. There have been new events that have captured the imagination. And local stars making a name for themselves internationally.
Well, away from all the celebrations, best mates now enjoying a well-earned rest and isn't likely to race again this season.
And of course, there have been sports that don't work as well on the global stage, and sports that look to have died out but are now making a resurgence. And teams like us that came and went. We have lasted a little longer than London Welsh, though. And we've come full circle, really, because Oxford United are looking for a new stadium, just as they were when we started. That is it from me.
What I like, Jerome, is that look at us. We've barely changed. Two decades have gone by. And
one of us,
changed.
Maybe.
You're talking about yourself. Thanks, Jerome.
Thank you, Geraldine.
Oh, thanks. Well, this is the moment I've been dreading since we were told we were closing back in May. This service has been going for 22 years. I've presented it for 21 and a half. It's been the biggest chapter of my career and a huge part of my life. I've had the privilege of presenting the programme, but of course, it's a team effort. We're a small team, and so often we've delivered more than we've been resourced to provide. I'm particularly proud to have been part of it in the last few months. Inevitably, there have been very difficult days since the closure was announced, but we've managed to stay on air in part because people on the team cancelled plans and took on extra responsibility. For me, the best part of this role has been the connection with you. We've been lucky to have such a loyal audience who've given us so many stories and trusted us to share them. I know many of you have written to the senior BBC bosses or to your MPs about the service. It's clear how much you value it and how sad you are to be losing it. Thank you for writing to me and talking to me in shops and on the streets. Your support has meant so much, and I found the kind words overwhelming so many times. The last 7 months would have been much harder without your concern and support. Now, most presenters, when they say goodbye, are either heading into retirement or off to a fabulous new job. That's not the case for me. It's scary. Sometimes it's exciting thinking about the future, but mainly it's scary. I'm hoping the new year brings a brilliant new adventure, but at the moment I have no idea what's in store. I'm going to take a pause for a couple of minutes so you can hear from someone who knows a bit more about the future than me, at least the next few days. David Brain is here with the weather forecast.
Good evening. We've had some lovely sunrise and sunsets so far this week, but boy, oh boy, has it been cold. This was first thing this morning with a beautiful sunrise, but look at the frost on the grass and in the hedgerows, and look at the temperatures. Last night we got down to minus 11. Perhaps not quite so cold tonight, thank goodness, but still a very frosty start to the day tomorrow. But the weekend is all changing, turning milder. We'll have some fine weather around tomorrow, but rain and for a short while, some snow for us on Sunday. There's an area of low pressure out here in the Atlantic. I know it's a long way away from us at the moment. We have high pressure. This weather front will just introduce more cloud tomorrow. That may help with the overnight temperatures. But through Saturday night and into Sunday, this whole area of cloud and rain will sweep in and it'll be with us on Monday as well. So much higher temperatures, higher than they have been so far this month, but also some outbreaks of rain. And that mild air, not just for us, by the way, right across the United Kingdom. So tonight we have a lot of clear sky. It means it's going to turn frosty again. Perhaps not minus 11, but certainly temperatures well below freezing, minus 6, possibly minus 7. Just a bit more in the way of cloud and a bit more of a breeze may help keep those temperatures up a little, but still a widespread frost to greet us tomorrow. Some patchy clouds, some sunny spells, a largely fine dry day tomorrow. But after that cold start, temperatures again going to struggle up to 4, maybe 5 degrees. Now, as we go into Saturday night and Sunday, here comes that band of rain. Won't properly get to us until daylight on Sunday, but just on the leading edge of that, there could well be some snow and a risk of freezing rain. So hence the risk of ice. There is a Met Office warning about that. And then by the time we get into the evening on Sunday, the temperatures are back up and we start to see some unusually mild weather as we go into the early part of next week. And that includes Christmas. Bye for now.
Davey Brain there with a wet weekend ahead. After tonight, you'll be getting South Today from Southampton instead of us. You're in good hands with the team there and they'll still be covering stories from this part of the world. They'll be doing the late news for us tonight because we are going to say goodbye for now, because that really is just about it from us. Thank you for being there. Thank you for the stories and thank you for your support. You have been the best audience a presenter could ask for. It's felt like I've been talking to friends every night, and thank you for letting me into your homes probably twice a day for the last 21 and a half years. Do please still say hello if you see me. I like it when you say hello. It is one of the best parts of this job, is getting to talk to people I wouldn't normally talk to. And if you want to see what's going on in my life, I've just joined Instagram. I'm a newbie, so I'm taking it very slowly. It might not be great at the moment, but I am there. So for one last time, that is it from me and the team here in Oxford. Thank you again. And from everyone here, goodbye.